Our saints will not be statesmen, and our statesmen will not be saints. That's the penultimate sentence of my book, The Religious Test, and it nicely encapsulates my argument in a single statement. And here's another way to summarize it. Liberal democratic government is a very great good, and so is serious, deep religious faith. But not all good things go together, and these two certainly do not. It seems to me that the religious right actively denies this claim. It wants to say that religion and politics harmonize really quite well, and thus that politicians should place their religious convictions at the core of their identities and at the center of their political campaigns. The religious test that I talk about in the title of the book refers, first of all, to this claim about the harmonious character of politics and religion, which I believe tests our political institutions and tests the political norms of liberal democratic government. But the title also refers to how I think our political culture should respond to this view of the religious right, this view about the harmoniousness of religion and politics, and that is by developing a religious test for political candidates. Now, this is not the kind of test that is proscribed rightly in Article 6 of the U.S. Constitution. This is the article that states that you may run for office in our country while belonging to any church, and also you may not be excluded from running for belonging to any church. So it goes positively and negatively. In other words, you can't have a requirement that, say, you're a member of the Anglican Church, as some of the founding fathers were concerned about. That is un-American and not in the Constitution. It's forbidden and very good. That's a very, very good thing. The religious test that I'm talking about has to do with a kind of informal attempt of engaged, informed citizens to ask tough, pointed, intelligent questions of the religious beliefs of our would-be political leaders. Now, I would say that these should be politically relevant aspects of religious beliefs. So I'll give you kind of first a negative example. In the run-up to the last presidential election, Jacob Weisberg, a columnist and editor of Slate magazine online, wrote a very critical comment column about Mormonism, about the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, in which he mocked Mormon religious beliefs, including the fact that most observant Mormons wear sacred undergarments. Now, I would say that that is something that's politically irrelevant. It doesn't matter what Mormons do with what they wear under their clothes. I can't think of any way that this would have a political effect. So that really is, I think, not only in bad taste, but inappropriate. That is not what I'm talking about. I would say that, on the contrary, though, Mormons do have views that would be very interesting and I think actually imperative for us as informed citizens to raise and talk about if Mitt Romney runs again, as we expect him to, or any other candidate who happens to be a member of the LDS Church. So for example, devout Mormons believe that the head of their church is a living prophet of God. That means that they believe that the head of their church, unlike the other 300 million of us in the United States, has a direct line to God. Members of the Mormon Church have called this prophet God's mouthpiece on earth. What would it mean to have a president who believed that one out of 300 million Americans and one out of 6 billion human beings on the planet has a direct line to the deity? It doesn't mean anything necessarily strange or troubling would happen, but it's an interesting question, and it's one that I think that informed citizens should be interested in asking. Similarly, Mormons believe, or at least many Mormons believe, this doesn't rise as much to the status of a doctrine, but it is very much kind of part of Mormon folk belief, that the Garden of Eden existed in Jackson County, Missouri. not somewhere else, perhaps in Africa or the current Middle East, as a lot of scholars would think today, but that it was on this continent, in what would be this country. And they often believe that when Jesus Christ returns as part of the Second Coming, he will rule the world from the territory of the United States. This has led to other folk beliefs on the part of many Mormons that there will come a time in American history when the Constitution will be, quote unquote, hanging by a thread, and that a Mormon will rise to become president and save the country and redeem the country in the name of Jesus Christ. Orrin Hatch, when he was running for president about a decade ago, made reference to this on a Utah radio station, talking about, I've never seen it so bad with the Constitution hanging by a thread. I think that is perfectly interesting, legitimate question to ask. But this raises things far beyond Mormonism. My book is not about Mormonism. I simply use those examples because they're particularly vivid, and I find that many Americans don't know these details about members of the LDS Church. But I don't want to be ganging up on them. I would say on the latter issue, the issue of sacred history, many Christians have views that I think are troubling enough that we should be asking very pointed questions. For instance, Mike Huckabee and Sarah Palin probably will be running for president in the next cycle over the next 2 years. Mike Huckabee is a Baptist minister. Sarah Palin is a Pentecostal. Many members of those churches believe that God guides America's role in the world. Many, you know, members of other churches believe that as well. But many members of those specific groups go on to believe that we might be approaching the end times very soon, that America's role in the world might have implications for the Middle East and when Jesus will come, and that maybe God is guiding America's actions in the Middle East in how we support Israel, how we confront Iran, and that this might have implications for all of human history because of the imminent return of Christ. Does Sarah Palin believe this, for example? Does Mike Huckabee harbor suspicion about the findings of science, about evolutionary biology, as many members of his church do, the Southern Baptists? So these are the kinds of questions that you know, I'll touch on other groups. But just to show you that I'm not beating up on Christians, I would say, you know, I also talk about Muslims. There's a lot of controversy about Islam, especially in the last 6 months, controversy about, you know, building mosques at Ground Zero and so forth. I would say I'm really not concerned about that. I would be much more interested in a Muslim candidate's view of Sharia law. Not that I think any Muslim candidate would run in this country on a platform of imposing it here, but Sharia law and its place in pluralistic societies is a very pressing, very interesting question around the world. In Europe, where there are many more Muslim immigrants than there are in this country, and where they tend to be more politically radicalized than they are here. And then throughout what is referred to as the Arab Muslim world, and then the Muslim world more generally. You know, this is, you could say, the fissure that defines the Muslim world and that leads to tensions, often very bloody tensions within the Muslim world today. Where do you stand on Sharia law, and should it be something privately held, publicly imposed under the threat of punishment by the state? Very important questions, perfectly legitimate. And just to show you, I'm not even anti-religious per se. I actually, I beat up a little bit on the new atheists in the book as well. I have a chapter about people like Christopher Hitchens, Richard Dawkins, and Sam Harris for what I call their illiberalism on a lot of these matters. In my view, their position amounts to being a kind of counter-religion that has many of the problems of the very fundamentalist types who they oppose. So, for example, Richard Dawkins opens a chapter of his book, The God Delusion, by saying that that he believes that raising a child within a faith community, and he's talking about Catholics at this moment, is a form of child abuse. He then, instead of, you know, if you simply assume that this is, you know, he's just kind of playing to the bleachers here, he doesn't really mean this, he goes on for about 10 or 15 pages to quote psychologists to back him up on this, although he never lets the other shoe drop to say, well, wait a minute, when you're accused of abusing children, the state can come in and arrest you, and the state can take your children away for their own protection. And most of us think this is a very good thing. Does Richard Dawkins actually believe that the state should go into the homes of religious believers and take their children to protect them from the religious education their parents are imposing on them? I don't really think, if push came to shove, he would support this, but clearly the implication of his argument is there. So all of these things, I think, are examples of, you could say, potentially failing what I call the religious test. So I would say, in closing, again, I want to leave my remarks fairly short so we have plenty of time to discuss. My view is that all of this, what I just said, these views and others that I talk about in the book, should be on the table for public discussion and scrutiny. But I want to be clear that my argument is very much a reaction to the rise of the religious right. They are the ones who have put religion on the table in the first place. They can't have it both ways. You can't insist that we should be bringing religion into our public life and then claim that religion should be given impunity from public scrutiny, which I hear happening a fair amount. And journalists go along with this. Ever since John Kennedy, faced criticism about his Catholic faith back in 1960, journalists have thought that it's perfectly okay to be very critical and sometimes mocking and denigrating to religion in general. But when it comes to a serious investigation of particular religious beliefs, particular religious convictions, they get very skittish. Part of this is because of kind of ignorance on their part about exactly what religion is, what religious people think, because journalists tend not to be very religious and perhaps don't even know that many people who are devout. But that shouldn't be an excuse. I would say that in a country where there is an active political movement of religiously committed traditionalist believers, these beliefs need to be examined, and our citizenship, healthy, informed, active citizenship requires it. If, on the other hand, religious believers want a free pass and don't want to be asked these kind of tough, again, respectful and intelligent, but tough questions, then maybe they shouldn't push quite so hard to bring that faith so aggressively into the public sphere. So that's, a synopsis of where I'm coming from, and let's start the conversation.